I'm Richard Grayson. I work as an artist, as a curator and a writer, and I'm here to curate and bring together the Adelaide International Exhibition for 2014. I used to be the director of the Experimental Art Foundation in Adelaide, a place dedicated to the slightly wilder shores of experimental visual arts practice, and then after that I had the interesting experience, the genuinely interesting experience, of being the curator of the 2002 Sydney Biennale. Then after that, I washed up in Berlin for a few years, where I returned to a focus on making my own work. And since then, I've made projects both as a curator and as a visual artist. The thing about art that I'm really interested in is actually the bit which just lies on the edge, really, of the sort of the rational bit of it. The way that art operates is a space for us to sort of make hypothetical guesses, leaps into the dark, where you're actually doing something that you don't quite understand what's happening there. And I don't mean that necessarily as in that romantic sort of, oh, I'm mad, me, I'm an artist. I mean it more in that thing of, it's a place where we as individuals and we as a society and we as a culture can variously sort of push the model, push the way that we might imagine how we might see the world and understand what happens to us. I mean, what I find intriguing about whatever this thing called art is that as a species we've been doing something that looks like it for an awful long period of time, even if we haven't necessarily called it art. So this is just like a contemporary expression of something that our nervous system has been doing ever since we sort of went bipedal and got language. The bit that really fascinates me about art is the bit you can't quite talk about, that edge, you know, what the hell is this? Each one of these events that you're going to go into are going to take you into a sort of world, into a slightly different world. You're going to experience either a biggish body of work by somebody that describes the world that that artist is mapping or describing, or the edge that they're trying to push, and then you're going to leave there, then you're going to sort of walk into another world. So hopefully it's going to be a series of immersive experiences.
Everywhere I've gone in my life, I have carried books. I was a really lucky kid. I grew up in a house full of books. For me as a reader began with Little Bear Book. I was 4 years old. And I can remember exactly the evening when all of a sudden the symbols became words. And I've never looked back. The first thing I do in a hotel is put books down. The first thing anywhere I do. And they're my comfort. They're an answer. They're a place that you can go. They give you solace, they give you joy. And yeah, I can't imagine a world in which if someone took all the books away, I just wouldn't know what to do. I'd be utterly lost. You know, one of the things I've found really interesting in the last, you know, when I was young, in being a teenager and in my early 20s, it was South American literature, you know, open this whole world, and so many of us are defined by writers like Borges and 100 Years of Solitude and what that meant. Well, you know, now we see this coming out of Africa, and there's this extraordinary literature that's beginning. And part of that is a result of the end of civil wars, because you do need peace. Unfortunately, for literacy, you know, they do tend to go together. But part of what we're seeing is the birth of a new literature. And that literature is also already a diaspora literature, so you're watching an African literature coming out of sub-Saharan Africa, North Africa, and Europe all at the same time in the United States. So I feel optimistic. You know, I feel like Shakespeare will always be there, but, you know, I want to know about the rest of the world. I mean, Chinese literature, we don't even know yet. Those of us, obviously, who don't speak Mandarin or can't read Chinese characters. And I just think it's exciting, you know? Slowly, Japanese literature is becoming into more, there's more translations. And I'm like, great, there's more than Murakami. There's lots of stuff. So I think it's an exciting time. Reading is, to my mind, as creative an act as writing. Literally, words have to be read in order to come alive. A book without a reader is typing. It's typeset, it's beautiful, it's an object to be admired. But I need to imagine what you imagined in my own way in order for it to exist. There's nothing ever passive about reading, and it requires creativity and it requires energy. So I think it's really important that we always remember that we need more readers than writers. It's as simple as that. But we also need to value the creativity that every reader brings to every book. Writers' Weeks are significant in lots of ways. Because the industry is struggling right now, we're filling a bit of a gap. We are still a growth industry, and writers still want to meet readers, and readers want to meet writers. And as marketing budgets shrink, we are able to do some of what publishers used to do. The program that we create becomes a guide. So there's all this noise in the world. There's all these books and bookshops, and we're at the beginning of that journey. So you pick it up, and I suspect even if you never come to Writers' Week, I mean, I read programs from festivals all over the world, you'll still be getting ideas about books you may want to read. If you do come, which is better for us, you'll get a sense of the writer and the writing. And that's why it's always important to us to get a little reading, get a lot of conversation, and get some questions in. Writers' Weeks offer a unique place for young and emerging writers to find an audience. And it's been a great privilege for me to bring first and second book writers to the festival, because it's hard. The review pages are shrinking. The internet is loud and noisy. And one of the things we say as directors and as organizations is we say, this is a good book. We recommend you read it. And we use the faith that many years, this event is now almost 54 years old, that kind of the trust of our brand, which sounds wanky, but it isn't. The trust you have in us, we can then give to young writers. And we can give to writers you may have never heard of. I think it's a really important thing.
I remember being taken by the school to the Liverpool Philharmonic Hall to see The Tales of Beatrix Potter with a live orchestra. So the film and orchestra thing has kind of been in my background for quite a long time. I must have been about eight then. And I've always, because I sang in the school choir, I played the violin from the age of nine. I was in the cathedral choir and the church choir. And I've just, it's what I've always done, because I've just never done anything else. And so my life has been a succession of interactions and relationships to the arts in one form or another. Even then, it was definitely a mix, because I was playing lead second violin in the Merseyside Youth Orchestra, and I was the lead singer in a punk rock band. So it kind of, that I suppose if you could characterize it as anything, it's that fact that it's always been a range of different things that I've got a range of different things out of. By that point, of course, I was going out to gigs and I was going to see a lot of bands, but I was also going to concerts and by that point, theater as well. So I've always got out of it a lot of different things from a lot of different art forms, I suppose. No, I definitely couldn't work in accounting. I've always done something related to the arts. I started out as an arts journalist. I started my own arts publication. I then went into working in theatre. I then was working in music. So I don't think, at this point, I think it's too late to retrain into a proper job. I think I am actually incapable of doing anything that isn't fundamentally arts-based. You can only have civilization with the presence of the arts. I think you can have the world, but I think in terms of a world without culture is not civilization. It is the civilizing medium of society, and it excites, it energizes, it communicates, it educates, it illustrates, it emotes. Culture can do all of those things that just talking can't. And whether that's music, or whether that's books, or whether that's film, or whether that's theater or dance, that all of those things are achievable through the media of all the different cultures that we showcase in the festival. The Adelaide Festival has always taken chances. It has always been known on this continent as the festival that is the first to do things, and the ambitious one, and the bold one. And that's what's so exciting for me, and clearly for the audience about the Adelaide Festival, is that there is a license in that. context to be able to take risks. And as an artistic director and as a programmer, that's what you want. You want an audience that will say, what's the new thing that we haven't heard of before that is going to excite us? What's the thing that's going to shock us? I feel like what the Adelaide Festival provides pretty much uniquely to Australia, I think, is this history of risk-taking. I mean, obviously, there is an expectation that there will be this mix of art forms, which is absolutely fine, and that's what you want. I feel like, in terms of what I did last year and what I'm doing with the festival we're about to launch, is certainly providing the context to mix up, for example, the music program, and do things that have not been necessarily in the festival before. That what you are doing is you're providing a logical context to put something into a festival program which wouldn't be here otherwise, which is not touring, which is not just, if the festival wasn't here, this would be. And addressing things like electronic music in the way that we would address theatre or dance, and providing the most fantastic, the cream of the crop in terms of what's brand new, what's influential, what's had an impact or is having an impact. And I feel I take a similar approach to all the art forms. I'm looking for those things as much in the contemporary dance program as I am in the contemporary music program, as I am in the theatre program. It's to move the game along. It's to showcase innovation and excellence. It's to show things that I find exciting and inspiring, and put them up there and go, this is the best in the world. This is what's happening right now. This is what's out there that everyone's getting excited about, and show it to the audience here. You know, obviously technology has had a huge impact already on the arts, and that's a conversation that, although it continues, has been happening for 20 years. So you can't really talk about technology as being what's going to impact the arts in the future, because it already has. I don't know what the next one's going to be. I feel like the experiencing of live arts gets more important with the fewer opportunities to mix. I feel like it becomes the village pump. The idea of this being the place where you get together and have a shared experience, I feel that's only got more important. I mean, the great predictions of the past 20 years that it would be the death of the concert hall because you could experience all this stuff at home and online. I don't think that's true. I think, if anything, the live experience becomes a more important part. And you've only got to look at all the concert halls still being built around the world. It's the classic thing that the ownership of first video and then DVD players increased the frequency of people going to cinemas rather than decreasing. And I feel like the multiplicity of formats in which you can experience things on your own makes people more inclined to want to go out and share those things with other people. Look, I feel like what I'm doing is continuing an honourable tradition of a festival that is allowed to be, you know, a little bit redefined, allows itself. And in a very real sense, that should be the point of changing directors every 4 years, is that I'm going to bring to it my own take on what it should be. And that means it will always have that background of a mix of new music and what I regard to be the very best in contemporary dance. When I sit in a theatre and go, I have never seen anything like this before, and I think it's fantastic. That's the experience I am looking for, and that's the experience I want to share with the audiences and go, you really have to see this. I mean, they really have to see Roman Tragedies. You should not miss it's one of the best nights I've ever spent in a theatre in my life. So what I'm doing is going, trust me, you will like this. And I'm excited about Richard's visual arts program and Nick's visual arts program. And I think it's great to have such top line visual arts curators coming in and inputting work at the same kind of standard in galleries that we're putting into theatres and concert halls. Similarly with Laura, that's right up to the moment of what's going on in the written word. I mean, they, you know, we have the youngest ever Booker Prize winner who we had before she won the prize. And it's absolutely of the moment. There's a lot of new work in there, a lot of new names. So it's brilliant to have such a kind of consistently fresh approach to the whole festival.
Thank you. Nina Marnie. Puliana miuna pindi miuna kuma. Mat nyanga gana miuna nai wangani mani na budni. Tapitla, nadlo porachi gana yutanga yuandi. Mani nadlo ya tapindi. Nadlo yako bindi bindi wakanino buku onako. Nadlo menga mananindi buku onako. Nata, padiadu maranga puliana miuna pindi miuna kuma. Padiadu wadu.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to also acknowledge that the land that we meet tonight on is that of the Kaurna people. At the Adelaide Festival, we take seriously our acknowledgement of the custodial and spiritual relationship between this land and the Kaurna people today. The Honourable Premier of South Australia, Jay Weatherill, Minister for the Arts. The Honourable Chloe Fox, Minister Assisting the Minister for the Arts. The Honourable Leon Bicknell, Minister for Tourism. Mr Stephen Marshall, Leader of the Opposition. Ms Vicky Chapman, the Deputy Leader of the Liberal Party. The Honourable David Ridgway, Shadow Minister for Tourism. Attending Adelaide City Councillors, Councillor Llewellyn Smith, representing the Lord's Mayor tonight. Councillor Mullany, Councillor Wilkinson, Councillor Williamson. Mr Richard Ryan, Chair of our Board and Festival Board members, Adelaide Festival partners, angels, friends, patrons and festival guests. Welcome to the 2014 Festival Program launch, and we are thrilled that you could join us this evening, and we're thrilled to be able to share with you the ideas and thoughts that we've been working on for a very long time. A special welcome also to the members of our deaf and sight impaired communities with whom we've developed a very special relationship, and we thank them for their support over many festivals. And also, for the first time tonight, we are live streaming this launch. So I'm very proud to welcome all of our supporters who are watching on a screen anywhere in the world. This is an exciting time for the Adelaide Festival. Considered by many one of the most prestigious festivals in the world, we have just completed one of our most successful festivals in many, many years that saw an increased economic impact for the state, growth in tourism from people coming to the festival from interstate and overseas, broader new audiences, younger audiences, events that captivated the city, and broad public and critical acclaim across the entire program. We successfully targeted younger and new audiences, especially first-time attendees. But we are not content to sit back and just enjoy the laurels of past successes. It is our plans for the next few years, building upon the recent successes this year, which excite us as we extend and broaden our reach nationally and internationally as a festival at the very pinnacle of international festivals around the world. As many of you will know, having heard me speak before, I'm incredibly passionate about this state, and I'm incredibly passionate about this festival. As a South Australian, I'm incredibly proud that we have a festival of this standing in the city, and it is the next few years that we think will be crucial to us in maintaining and developing this status further. And it is you, our supporters and our friends, who help us to strive to achieve the success in artistic leadership and international acclaim. So never underestimate the power that you have in our successes, because we need each and every one of you to enable us to bring the very best on offer to Adelaide each and every year. I would be remiss if I did not mention how much we value our corporate supporters who provide us with crucial support, and we have 34 individual corporate supporters. But I'd also like to draw specific attention to individuals who join us as our friends, angels and patrons. Because for me, it is this base from which we will grow and flourish, and how we will meet the new challenges and keep at the forefront of festivals around the world and everything that we need to achieve in future years. So thank you to all of you out there who have already signed up, And for those of you who might still be considering, please come and join us, jump on board, because your contribution really makes a difference. Some very quick personal thank yous before I step aside, because you're all here to hear David unleash his program tonight, and I'm very much the warm-up act. But I'd like to offer my personal thank you to all of our board members who offer a lot of time and expertise to support and assist us. To Laura Crouch, Richard Grayson, and of course David Sefton, thank you for the daily passion and inspiration. You provide the highest level of artistic vision that I could ask for as a CEO. And most importantly, to every single staff member who works on this festival. You're the engine room of what we deliver. You put the flesh on the bones of our ideas, and you make the magic happen. We really could not create what we create without them as well. They are exceptional, and I thank them. We are lucky to have every single one of them working with us. But let's move on. I'd like to welcome now to the stage the chair of our Adelaide Festival Board, Mr. Richard Ryan, and I'll see you in March.
Thank you, Karen. Festival guests, since its inception in 1960, the Adelaide Festival has always sought to showcase outstanding, sometimes bold, and very often inspirational arts events from around the world. In doing so, it has become recognised for its excellence, its innovation, and its artistic leadership. And inevitably, over that time, it's also come to occupy a unique place in the social, cultural, and economic landscape of South Australia. It's a central platform of the state's reputation and international identity. With this in mind, in 2012, the state government committed to fund the Adelaide Festival on an annual basis, a complex undertaking for an arts event of the size, scale, and as multifaceted as our festival. I must acknowledge our government partners, the Government of South Australia through Arts SA and the Adelaide City Council. Now in its second annual delivery, the addition of the Adelaide Festival to South Australia's annual calendar of events was a brave one, and one which affirms South Australia's commitment to the arts and arts excellence. As you all well know, ensuring that we remain at the very pinnacle of festivals internationally costs a substantial amount of money, and we are grateful to receive significant assistance through our many generous partners. We acknowledge the generous partnership of our 2014 major partners, Bendigo and Adelaide Bank, The Advertiser, Channel 7, and the ABC. I'm particularly pleased to welcome on board Qantas, an unconscious joke, I must admit, joining our existing airline supporter, Emirates, as well as Volvo through Solitaire Automotive, specialised legal practice, Lipman Caris, and Jolly's Boathouse. I must acknowledge all our previously existing loyal sponsors for their ongoing support, especially those who've been with the festival for many years. The generous support that we receive from these organisations and all the leading and visionary organisations that you see on the screen behind me enables us to bring world-class events to Adelaide and to Australia. This support from our sponsors is vital to the ongoing success of the festival, and I'm delighted to share in the enthusiasm and sustenance provided by these leading and visionary companies during this exciting time in our history. I take this opportunity to acknowledge the Australian Council for the Arts through the Major Festivals Initiative, the Gordon Darling Foundation, as well as the Literature and Visual Arts Boards that support a number of key events in our program. I would also like to thank the foreign governments that support visiting artists to Australia. These include the Australian India Council, Axion Cultural Espanola, Canada Council for the Arts, Cervantes Institute, Dutch Foundation for Literature, the Embassy of Italy, the New Zealand Book Council, the Embassy of the United States of America, and Ramon Yui Institute. With this support, we've been able to expand on the success of the 2013 festival, providing David Seston with the opportunity to select a program that is once again international, highly innovative, and importantly, inclusive. Please join me now in thanking all our partners, our festival director, David, our CEO, Karen, the director of Writers' Weeks, Laura Kayroach, the director of the Adelaide International, Richard Grayson, the festival board, the staff, of course, and all our wonderful volunteers. And now it's my pleasure to invite to the stage the Premier of South Australia, the Honourable Jay Weatherill.
Well, thank you, Richard. And it's my great pleasure to be here to launch this quintessentially South Australian festival. On this very stage, in this very spot, I heard Gough Whitlam say at Donst Dunstan's memorial service that during the Dunstan era, a light shone so brightly from Adelaide that it lit up the whole of Australia. Dunstan encouraged South Australians to unabashedly express a progressive, creative approach that is the South Australian way. The Adelaide Festival has, from 1960, added much to this light. It is still regarded as Australia's foremost arts festival and one of the most prestigious arts festivals in the world. More than an opportunity for artists to indulge in a range of artistic expressions, this festival prompts and encourages audience to perceive the world around them from a different perspective. It reaffirms to local audiences the creative outlook that helps make South Australia a unique and special place to live. This creative mind informs our innovative approach to governance, democracy, and business. And the festival promotes to visitors a positive and forward-looking image of South Australia. It enhances the state's reputation and creates a flourishing environment for vibrancy. It also has a direct and positive impact on the state's economy. Festivals are a unique time when you can be a little more adventurous, and I encourage everyone present to try something new. It invites participation. Indeed, the former Premier, Don Dunstan, actually did participate in many artistic pursuits, famously with actor Keith Michelle. But I can rest assured that I will not be following in his footsteps. The Adelaide Festival is a fully curated event, so that every selection in this year's program has been wonderfully crafted by Artistic Director David Seston. And I want to congratulate David for this program that will put the festival at the forefront of international arts festivals in the country. From Friday 28th of February 2014, the Adelaide Festival will delight and engage audiences with the very best that the world has to offer in arts and entertainment over a full 17 days. The 2014 Adelaide Festival incorporates the Writers' Week, the only literary festival of its type in Australia, which has remained predominantly free to the public, as well as the biennially presented Visual Arts Festival. Adelaide International, curated in 2014, by that wonderful artist, Richard Grayson. A wide variety of artistic mediums are therefore available to suit every possible taste. Such a program begs the public to engage. Festivals give communities the opportunity to celebrate, to expand their understanding of the world and different cultures locally, nationally, and internationally. I've had the opportunity to view the program, and 2014 promises to be one of the most exciting and extensive festivals that we've ever seen on offer. Over 900 artists will participate in over 50 separate events and over 150 performances. Of those, 29 events are exclusives. You'll not be able to see them anywhere else in this country. The program also reflects South Australia's inclusive attitude to the arts. The Adelaide Festival will further its award-winning access program that provides everyone the opportunity to attend, and to participate in festival events. But finally, before I close, I would like to acknowledge the hard work of the dedicated Adelaide Festival team, Karen and her team, all of the extraordinary work that's brought us to this day. Your passion for this event runs consistently through the organisation, the development of the program, and the excellence with which it's presented. I'm confident that the program you're about to see will do justice to your dedication and the expectations of the South Australian community. Thank you very much.
The Ediacara Hills. Here lie animals whose body plans are fundamentally the same as those of almost all animals alive today, including us. And about 550 million years ago, their differently organized bodies gave them something quite new. Mobility. Once you start to move, you develop a front end, and that becomes your head. And you also, by definition, have a back end, and in between, segments on which you can add appendages. On that basic pattern, you can add further features. On the front end, that's where you need sense organs, eyes, feelers. On the appendages, you can modify them to be hooks and claws, which helps you catch things. And at the back end, there will be a paw from which you excrete the waste product. And that is the basic body plan of almost all the animals that are alive on Earth today. How was it that animals had suddenly become so complex? The Ediacara Hills may hold the evidence for an answer to that question.
Evening. Well, here we are again. That was quick. Not the last 20 minutes, that was quite slow. Oh, I'm in so much trouble already. Welcome, thanks for coming. Let me tell you about the Ediacaran. Well, actually, Sir David did a fairly good job. Thank you, Sir David, off the telly. Thank you, virtual Auntie Josie. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Jay. Thank you, Karen. That's enough thank yous for the rest of your adult lives. It's like going to the pictures and all the having to sit through all the credits at the start, isn't it? Without the option to leave. So it was during the festival last year with Scott Wright, who did the puppet show Murder. We were sitting in our kitchen, and he said, "You know that the first signs of complex life were discovered in South Australia." I said, "No, I did not know that. Why is that not on the number plates?" And so I put it on the poster. It is something we should be rightly proud of, and it's been fantastic. It's been great because we went to the obvious source. We went to the museum and talked to the experts, and have had a fantastic journey coming up with the design, which is based on Ernst Haeckel's Art Forms in Nature. I'm sure you already knew that, though. And it's one of those things that it's quintessentially South Australian, and there's a lot of I feel there's a lot to celebrate about South Australia. You just don't do it very often. So, be proud. Anyway, I was very happy with last year. It went great. Thank you for coming to all those shows. It was a great success. But I'm even more excited about the coming festival, which I will continue to say every year, obviously. But right now, 2014 is the best festival I've ever produced. And I stand by that until next year. It's great. One of the overwhelming things I kept getting back off people, so it's all your fault. People kept saying to me, what is it that's going to shock me? What is it that's going to challenge me? What's the thing I haven't heard of that I'm going to love? So you're going to get shocked, you're going to get challenged, and there's going to be loads of stuff you've never heard of. By the way, I am actually sitting in an Edie Akron. I never thought that's sitting in the kitchen with Scott. excuse me. So, Mark Twain once defined insanity as doing the same thing repeatedly and expecting a different result. So, let's go. That's the photograph of opening night last year. There were 25,000 people in the park because we counted them. So when people tell you they had 25,000 people in the park, that's what it looks like. And if you were there, you know you could not have got through it with a warm spoon. You'd never have got a dragon with loads of school children through there. Just saying. So it was a massive success. I mean, I could not have gone better. I really could not have been happier. And then I spent a year going, oh, shit. That was really successful. What am I going to do next year? Oh, streaming. Don't swear. Note to self. Is shit all right? That's not one of the big ones. Anyway, so I decided we wouldn't get down to the intellectual stuff until, you know, slightly later. We'd just have a huge party. So I booked two of the biggest party bands in the world, and I'd run video, and then I'll talk about them afterwards.
Let's make this world a brighter day for you.
Charles Bradley was like the monster hit of Barrio in 2012, just one of the best live acts of that festival. And Kid Creole is just great and has never been to Australia before, which I was quite stunned by when we made the approach. So basically, it's just a huge party. So bring alcohol, come and have a dance. Oh, and by the way, the good news about this evening, it's not just me. There is a band. I'll tell you about them later. And also, Laura and Richard will both come out and talk about their fabulous programs and break up the monotony of having to listen to me all night. So anyway, that's moving on now. In the spirit, I'll let you, small secret now going on the internet, I tried to get this show for 2013, but it was too big to pull off in 1 year. And this is, I'd say, one of my top 10 shows of all time. Can you imagine how many shows I've seen in 25 years of doing this for a living? The answer is lots. And this, in the tradition of this festival, of doing the Mahabharata, Seven Streams of the River Ota, the Ring Cycle, it's very long. And it's I have a famously short attention span. And this is about 5 1/4 hours, 5 1/2 hours. And it'll be on this stage, and so will you if you wish to be, because behind the set, there is a cafe and a bar on this stage. So you can come and buy a drink and sit on a sofa and watch it on the telly. I saw it in New York, and the last scene, it's the Shakespeare history, Roman history plays. So it's Coriolanus, Julius Caesar, Antony and Cleopatra. And the last section, which is the last 45 minutes of Antony and Cleopatra, they actually clear everybody from the back and put you all back in your seats. Excuse me. And I remember, I knew that was going to happen. And I remember going, oh my God, 4 1/2 hours have gone. Now that never happens to me. I'm the one after 25 minutes going, how much more is there? It is, for me, one of the great theatrical experiences I have had in recent years. Do not miss this show. This is the one that in 10 years' time, like they all talk about going to the hills to see the Mahabharata and going to the Thebe to see Seven Streams, this is the one. Let's do the film.
Als twee machten zich verheffen en geen van beiden overheerst. De chaos snel de leegte tussen beiden vult en de ene macht de andere meesleurt in zijn val.
Niet omdat ik minder van Caesar hield, maar omdat ik meer van Rome hield.
Ik ben hier om te vertellen wat ik weet.
Kom weer tot leven door mijn kussen. Als mijn lippen die macht hadden, wegkussen zouden ze.
It's honestly, it's just great. Just trust me, just go. That's it. Now, this guy. This happened. The festival directors on this continent have been trying to get John Zorn to Australia for the past 25 years. And if you already know who John Zorn is, I don't have to tell you why. If you don't, it's because he is one of the most significant musicians on the planet. And I deal quite a lot in hyperbole, but I'm not hyperbolizing. He's considered to be one of the preeminent musicians in the jazz field who just effortlessly, seamlessly moved across into working in classical music, working with people out of the pop world and rock world. He is respected by the world of music like no other musician, and he's never been to Australia. I mean, I worked with him years ago, and the start of this was a deceptively straightforward email conversation that said, John, why have you never been to Australia? Best wishes, David. And I got a reply back literally 10 minutes later saying, hi, David. No one's ever offered to do it properly. Love, John. That deceptively simple exchange kind of led to quite... Then, of course, what you go back and say is, define properly. properly is pretty full on, I have to say. It's a career retrospective, 4 nights long. I've worked it out. It's 24 hours of music. And 40 people on the road, from all of whom are many very established artists in their own right. Mike Patton from Faith No More is coming. John Medeski from Medeski, Martin & Wood is coming. And you can go through the list of all of these. Mark Rebo, who's Elvis Costello's main guitarist, and half of Tom Waits' band is in the band. And it's this incredible list of performers, all 40 of whom are independently impressive artists, all of whom, and I have to say, in terms of the concluding the simple email theme, Christmas Eve last year, an email went out to all 40 of them and me, that just said, "Hi guys, looks like Australia's finally happening. Hold the dates. Love, John." It's great. I want it framed on my wall. One of my colleagues in one of the other Australian festivals said when he found out I got this, he felt sick. You know you're doing something right when your colleagues feel sick. So this will take place over 4 nights in here. As is the way, a festival is an organic, living beast. The brochure's already wrong. And you haven't even got it yet. That could be a new record. The first night will be the Masada Marathon, which will run 5-6 hours. You'll see a theme emerging. I don't do themes, but I've just got an awful lot of long shows in this festival. The Masada being the core of his improvisational work and the core of his jazz work. That's the first night, big, different configurations of Masada. The second night is the classical night. Ignore the brochure. It's true. Trust me. I should know. The third night is a collection of his film work and Cobra, which is other improvisational style, and a trio concert. Says duo. Trust me. As I say, I do have the skinny on this stuff. Ideally, everything I booked would end up in the brochure, and for the most part, we're okay. And on the fourth night, Zorn at 60, which is, I mean, he is 60 now, which is slightly depressing, because you look at that and think, well, what the hell? What are you doing, bathing in asp's milk or something? He was 60 about a month ago. And that is a recent picture. And so Zorn at 60 is the show that's been touring the world. And that's a song concert and another big concert to end. This will only ever happen once in Australia. Because he's actually said, because he's not a big traveler. He doesn't really particularly like traveling. He's the hardest working man I've ever met, but he doesn't really travel. And so he's actually, because I said, do you want to go and play anywhere else in Australia? No, I just want to do it here once. I said, and can we say this is the only time you're ever coming? Yep, it's the only time I'm ever coming. So if you want to see John Zorn live on this continent, you have to come to Adelaide or just come to the Festival Centre if you live here already. So, onwards. Oh, yeah, let's show the film. Could not be happier. And another coup. Matthew Barney, if you already know, as I don't have to explain, but I suppose that goes for everyone. is there's a category of radical filmmakers who make these epic films, and there's only really one person in that category. It's Matthew Barney. He made a series of films back in the 90s, probably the 90s, into the 2000s, called The Cremaster Cycle, which was here, I believe, at some point. He stands alone in the field of making these extraordinary, epic, it's another epic, 5.25 hours this time. In my own defense, it was only 4 hours long when I booked it. That's what you get for booking something that isn't finished yet. He goes out and makes these, and when I say he's alone in a field of his own, because this is fundamentally very, very high art and not suitable for families. In the rehearsal, I left myself extremely open by saying, if you ever wanted to know what a talking asshole looked like, and everyone just laughed. I thought, yeah, that's a straight guy line, if ever I heard one. I can wait. Because there is one in the film. But my staff were very mean to me. Or about me. So, I mean, this film, Ellen Burstyn, Maggie Gyllenhaal, Paul Giamatti, all these incredibly famous people are in this film, which is sort of, it's themed around Norman Mailer's Ancient Evenings, and he started it as a series of live events, which he filmed. And when he got to the third one, it was going to take years, and so it then became a film. But it's loosely based around ancient Egypt and the collapse of the motor industry in Detroit, obviously. His work is extraordinary in its scale, and hey, hang on a minute, we haven't got to Batshuayi yet. Can you back up, please? You can't back up. I'm being told to move faster, I think. Anyway, Matthew Barney, fantastic. Capri Cinema, they've never seen the like. Don't bring your children. Batshuayi Dance Company, first here in 1996, made their Australian debut. One of the finest dance companies on the planet. Still not hyperbole, if it's true. Okay, roll the film. And I'll try and keep up. Really amazing. I saw Saturday 21 in Paris, which by coincidence is where I had lunch with the agent manager of the next person in the festival. We can move on now. I've frightened him. So Isabella Rossellini made a series of short films for Sundance or the Independent Film Channel, Sundance, I think, about the sex life of insects and small mammals. And I was having lunch with the guy who's her agent. He said, oh, yeah, Isabella Rossellini's making a live show out of those short films. I went, I'm having that. Talk about making an offer you couldn't refuse. So we've got Isabella Rossellini, and the show, they're still making it. It opens in Los Angeles soon, in November. And she's working with Jean-Claude Carrier, who's another extraordinary character who's worked with everyone as a scriptwriter and film person. She's become something of an expert on the subject. And when you see all the photos, I know, go figure. I can't wait for this. I have seen most of the shows that appear in my festival, but I'm so looking forward to seeing this one. It will be in a class of its own. I am so pleased that we've got her. It's like, we've got Isabella Rossellini. That'll make a few other festival directors sick too, hopefully. All right, speaking of the seven streams of the River Oise, we have Robert Lepage too. Needles and Opium is an early piece by the renowned Canadian director. And if you saw Seven Streams, this is not 7 hours long, by the way, in sharp contrast. And neither is Isabella Rossellini. We're back down to a more manageable length now. Needles and Opium was predates Seven Streams, actually, and was one of the two pieces, this and Tectonic Plates, were the pieces that first set the hallmark of his use of technology and his use of actors interacting with technology. And of course, over the course of probably 20 years, the technology's improved massively. So they contacted us and said, wanted to go back, revisit this piece, which is about addiction and its role in the artistic process. And it's a lovely show, but because, of course, the technology is so much better now. So it's a complete reinvention of the show. And I mean, I saw the original version, which was fantastic and very good. One of those things you just go, wow, when you see it. This is a real treat. It's only coming to us, which, you know, we do a fair amount of sharing, but it's quite nice to have the things that only come to you. It will be a huge hit, this show. All right, on to the first of my vampires. I swear I didn't go around looking for people that appeared in vampire television shows for this festival. But if anyone watches True Blood, this is the Vampire King of Mississippi, all right? Dennis O'Hare, who, you know, before he was the Vampire King of Mississippi, he was a serious stage actor, and still is, did this piece. It's a one-man Iliad, and there's another accidental theme of reinterpretations of classic texts, done as a kind of contemporary, gritty New York downtown. It won a bunch of OBs. It sat off Broadway for ages. It's a fantastic show. There's something extremely compelling about really, really great one-man performances or one-woman performances. There's a couple in this festival, and it's a captivating work. I do recommend it to your attention. This is our second radical Shakespeare take. This is an Aboriginal King Lear, which has just opened in Melbourne to rapturous reviews. The Shadow King, and have a little clip of this one. It's a great version. You kind of figure it's a play about land. It's kind of surprising it hasn't been done before. It's a really hard, gritty work, which I think I'm really looking forward to having here. Now, I also feel very strongly that when you have something good on your doorstep, you should make a song and dance about it. And what we have on our doorstep is Windmill Theatre, who are one of the... who are not just a local treasure, they're a national treasure. And they do one of the most difficult things best, which is making work for older kids, transitioning into young adults. And everyone on the planet flagellates themselves on how difficult it is to do that, whereas women will just go out and do it. And I had a conversation with Rose, the director, about Girl Asleep, which is basically their Sleeping Beauty. And she said to me, well, we see it as the third part of a trilogy, our Rites of Passage trilogy. So I said, why don't we do them all? So only here, and only at the Adelaide Festival, the world premiere of Girl Asleep, we will put Fugitive back up, which I've only seen on video and I'm quite excited about. And we'll put School Dance back up as well, which was one of my highlights of the 2012 festival. So the three of those will be in rep through the whole festival, and I just feel it's an entirely deserved commitment to one of our greatest local companies. Run video.
I think we should get going now.
It's time for the odd to get even.
So, are you ready to dance?
So that's good. By the way, the other good news about tonight is there is alcohol at the end, and I'm catching up with myself. 16 pages to go. All right, speaking of intelligent work for children, when you have a child, you come to the very sharp realization of how crap most theatre for children is, and how that's somehow acceptable. And it's not. Because we have to suffer through it too. This I saw in Edinburgh 2 years ago, and it is fantastic. It was one of my Edinburgh highlights, regardless of the fact that it was a kids' show. Shona comes out of the company Catherine Wheels, the Scottish company who were here at the centre with a beautiful show called White, that came here a couple of years back, which was basically a kids' show if Samuel Beckett had written kids' shows. And just wonderful, another one of my big faves. But this is, if you have kids, even if you don't, borrow one and come and see this.
Maybe a clue. Missing.
And obviously, do ask permission before you borrow the child. I can just see that headline in the advertiser tomorrow. All right, onwards. Swiftly onwards. So, Antronchode. Easy for me to say. No, it isn't. The Belgians that were tying you into wheelchairs last year. Or various sort of snogging. If you snogged a stranger last year and having bought a festival ticket, it was them. Border Project, another fabulous local treasure. These guys have actually been in conversation for quite a long time. Some of you obviously do know Border Project, have perfected this amazing technology where you get to steer the course of the show from the audience. To the extent that when I was on the road recently, a director in Europe said to me, "Oh, I want to borrow their technology. Can you get me an in to them?" They're quite well known for it now. So they've actually been trying to come up with a show together. Antronchode, OG for short, thankfully. Do a lot of stuff, obviously, interactive with the audience. And they've come up with this show, topically enough, given when we will do it, which is about the process of voting and politics. And in which the cast will try and get to win your vote, and you get to decide who stays and who goes.
Ladies, gentlemen, lend me your ears. It has often been said that you can't have a show without an audience, and well, tonight, that is more true than ever. Because tonight, we will not only need your eyes, your ears, but at the center of everything will be your voice. Ladies, gentlemen, welcome to Fight Night.
I've actually seen the show twice. I won't tell you what happens because that would spoil it. But it just is, it will take you on a journey. Not quite, they won't quite tie you into a wheelchair or snog you, but it's a great show. Okay, onwards. This guy, again, the same festival as Josephine Bean. There's always a show in the festival that, because obviously we all kind of circulate the festivals, you bump into colleagues in the pub. And there's always one show that people say, have you seen dot, dot, dot? And this was it 2 years ago in the festival. It is an extraordinary... Valentine, who it's my second extraordinary one-man show. He's actually in Fight Night. Because I saw this show, and it's based on a series of historical monologues. It's just him, starting with Plato and going to George Bush. And he weaves in various points and it is completely amazing. And I collared him afterwards, and I went up and said, I'd really like to bring this show to the Adelaide Festival. He went, oh, I think I'm already coming to the Adelaide Festival. And at that point, I didn't know he's also in the cast of Fight Night. He's an extraordinary artist, and this show is... I just sat there completely blown away, and it's all just him and the table of microphones. There's a bit of clip to demonstrate.
Happy birthday, Mr. President. Mr. President.
We're last! We're last! Thank God Almighty! We are free at last! We are free at last!
I wanna live in America. Okay, buy me in America. Everything's free in America. For a small fee in America.
Misschien zijn die alle moslims terroristen. Maar alle terroristen zijn precies wel moslims.
I lost my house. I lost all my cars. But hey, I still got my family. And more important, I still got my spirit.
It is jaw-droppingly good. You just sit there going, wow. He's fantastic. All in the original languages, from the Plato on. And I know no one likes a smart ass, but I mean, really, he's pretty impressive. All right, let's keep going. Now, this is an interesting guy. And yes, that is a Kentucky Fried Chicken bucket on his head. Oscar emerged... from the original stand-up comedy, alternative cabaret, as it was back in the day, scene in the 70s in the UK, threw up, and I use the term advisedly, a whole bunch of people that weren't comedians. You got all the Ben Eltons and the Alexi Sayles and all those people, but you also got this set of people that really were basically performance artists that got gigs on the cabaret circuit. And Oscar is absolutely a prime example of that. And I, on and off, I've worked with Oscar for, a long time, 20-odd years. He doesn't perform very often. He teaches. There's lots of companies in New York claiming him as a reference source. He writes books, lives in Spain. And every now and again, we'll sort of emerge to make a new show, and he's never less than bonkers. Sorry if you're watching, Oscar. But I mean that in the best possible sense of bonkers. He's one of a kind. He's a unique artist. I hate the word unique, used far too often. But there's only one Oscar McLennan. We've commissioned the show, and so I'm dying to see how this pans out. But I think actually it will be fascinating. He's a fascinating artist. I have a huge respect for him. All right. Speaking of fascinating nutcases. The self-described most disgusting man in the world. I think we'll leave this to John.
Hello, Australia. I'm John Waters, the Pope of Trash, as I have been so humbly called. The Prince of Puke, the Duke of Dirt, the Anal Ambassador. Yep, those are my royal titles. That's me, I hope. No demand that you come see my spoken word act, this filthy world. Filthier and dirtier when I play your fair city. And that's soon. You heard me. Live, in person. Yours truly. Ready to turn your ears into garbage cans. Buy a ticket now or I'll have you killed.
I really couldn't have put it better than that. Also, don't bring your children. One of the funniest men on the planet, and just fantastic. I've worked with him 3 times in the States, and just amazing. He's just hilarious. And also an incredibly accomplished film director with an incredible back catalog. I'm not sure if back catalog is a word I should be using, but anyway, moving swiftly on. So, Xavier Samuel, my second vampire of the night. He's from Twilight, if you're not sufficiently young to know that. Trust me, I didn't. Local boy, made very, very good. The State Theatre got him when Spielberg was apparently on his heels. There's a visual gag here. When you get the brochure, you'll understand. Go to page 36. John Waters is on that page. Xavier Samuel is on that page. So when you close the brochure, you can see why he looks so nervous in that photograph. That is my wife's material. I have to credit where credit's due. I'm imagining we'll get a lot of young people going to see Chekhov that have never, ever thought of going to see Chekhov before in their lives. It's a brand new Seagull. It's a huge coup for the state. Back in the same space as last year. It's a great addition to the festival. All right. Sean Parker is fast becoming Australia's hottest export in the dance world. He can now sell out a whole week at Sadler's Wells, which is something like 10,000 tickets. And I am proud to be a co-commissioner of this, his latest and newest work, which the festivals of Australia have co-commissioned. At the moment, there's just been a very short extract done. It's literally brand new. But it's a compelling and beautiful piece, working with this extraordinary music, which is kind of the best way to describe it is like a kind of mashup of world music and Baroque. This will be a truly beautiful show. We have a quick clip. Very quick. I think that'll be lovely. All right, Stone Castro, there's an interesting one. I have to say first, we need to move the slide on. I told you, I'll get you out of here. I have to say first that they sit in the brochure as a dance show, but they're definitely in that category that falls as much into theater as to dance, in the same way as Alan Platel or many of the leading European companies, which is coincidentally where these guys, although Adelaide-based, the two of them basically spend most of their lives
off with Alan Platel or Sidi Larbi or with the major theatre and theatre dance companies of Europe. And this is their first major platform for the Adelaide Festival. Their pedigree is extraordinary in terms of who they work with. And it's an absolute slam dunk that they should be given the opportunity to work in their hometown. So I'm very happy to have that in there. It's a brand new show, so I look forward to seeing it with you. But yes, it's as much theatre as it is dance. We're doing well. We're up to page 41. All right, this Ilan Volkov, this is all Simon Lord's fault. Simon is the program director, artistic director or something of the Symphony, Adelaide Symphony Orchestra. And we talked when I first arrived about what we could do together, properly, collaboratively, between the ASO and the Adelaide Festival. And Simon said, you should meet Ilan. So I did. And this is where we ended up. Ilan Volkov is one of the most sought-after conductors on the planet now for straight big orchestral repertoire. He's constantly off doing proms and constantly off doing the major festivals of the world. But he has a deeper grasp and understanding of new music across the widest definition of what new music is of anyone I think I've ever met. He is quite spectacularly smart and very, very well informed. He really knows his shit. I think we've decided I can use that word. And tectonics is the result of his enthusiasm and knowledge. And what he does is he goes in and he works with a symphony orchestra on each time on a specific new music program. And this is kind of a festival within a festival. So, for instance, I saw tectonics in Reykjavik, and he worked with new music that was fundamentally Icelandic, but in the context of other music. He's done it in Tel Aviv. He's done it in Glasgow, which is where he was the BBC Scottish conductor. And so here we will work with new music from Australia. We have world premieres. We have a couple of major commissions for Australian composers. Working closely with the symphony it's a perfect festival collaboration because there's no way the symphony would be able to do this on the run of their program, and there's no way we'd be able to do it without their involvement. So over 2 days, we'll do one day in the Granger with the orchestral program, and then the next day in the Queen's. And there's literally everyone from the ritual is very much the background of Ilan's thinking on this. So that's everything from Xenakis and well-known new music composers right through to somebody like Grave Temple, which is two-thirds of Sono, for those of you who know about these things. So it's right at the edge of basically noise. That's what they call it. But it will take the orchestra into fundamentally uncharted territory for them, which is great, which is what a festival should do. And I'm delighted that Ilan is able to do this. And I think it's a great thing for the festival. So, I said last year I wasn't doing anything twice. I lied. In the middle of Unsound, I turned to my co-conspirators who'd come from Poland, even though one of them's from Wagga. And I didn't know that. I was emailing Poland thinking he was Polish. Fair summary. And I said, look, this is great. Let's do it next year. Because Unsound in the Queen's last year was such a spectacular success. And the quality of the work was so high. And there's so much of it out there in terms of, if you weren't there or don't know, it's a whole sort of review of what's going on in electronic music. And even more so this year, we've actually... And the whole thing about... doing the Snowtown live score. Jed, who did the score, Jed Cazell, who is the director's brother. I think it's fair to say that Snowtown, the score didn't get much attention in the scheme of things. But there's a strong local connection. And he's the brother of the director. And the score is completely stunning. And the world premiere of the live version of the score to Snowtown will start off the return of Unsound to Adelaide, alongside Stars of the Lid, who are a big deal on the international electronic music circuit and have never been to Australia. Working with an expanded Zephyr to form a chamber music group. So we will do, it's a similar model to last year, where we'll do a more classical electronica night in the town hall and then move into two nights in the Queen's. And across this bill, Morton Subotnick, in his 70s now, one of the godfathers of electronic music, never been to Australia. Nurse with Wound, one of the cult bands of this world, hardly ever play live, never been to Australia. And at the other extreme, Haxan Cloak, just put out the first record. He's probably 12. I mean, that's what I felt last year. I felt like I could be the father of most of the performers at Unsound last year. But and then you take someone like Moritz von Oswald, definitely one of the groups that are the superstars. Tony Allen, Fela Kuti's drummer, is the drummer with Moritz von Oswald. Cut Hands have just been added to an extraordinary band, and James Ferraro from the States. They were literally confirmed yesterday. It's funny how some things have been confirmed for 18 months, and then some were confirmed just prior to me coming onto this stage. So I'm really, really pleased to have Unsound back. It was such a success. The funniest conversations I had one kid come up to me in the audience and say, "I flew here from Perth to see this. I thought I was the only one that listened to this music." Well, thankfully, you were wrong. It was a total sellout last year, and the most satisfying part is that was the thing that people said to me before the festival. Yeah, electronic music in Adelaide, it isn't going to sell. Yes. It's great to be right once in a while. All right, moving on. The Tiger Lilies. Those of you who saw Shock-Headed Peter in 2000, this is the best thing they've done since Shock-Headed Peter. It's theatrical, it's beautiful, it's got that dark poignancy, it's the Coleridge Rhyme of the Ancient Mariner. They've worked with this extraordinary video maker. The clip is the best description. I love this show.
Hear the serpents screaming, know they will win. I see the storm clouds brewing, and I feel an evil wind. And yet I keep on dreaming of calm waters and us free. I know the palace we are building will drown within the sea.
Just go. What can I say? Just go. It's such a beautiful show. Okay, right, let's keep this show on the road. Next up, I'm very, very happy that we'll welcome back the Australian String Quartet with a program called Continuum. Very happy about this. They've put together a fantastic program, which at the core of it is one of my favorite pieces of music, which is George Crumb's Black Angels, which is one of the defining contemporary pieces of quartet music. I love the quartet. I love that piece of music. It's ask me later, I'll tell you about meeting George Crumb. That was an interesting one. We also will bring the music of Viva offering for next year back, which is the Kellerman Quartet from Hungary. Which I think you'll find when the slide moves, that they are a strangely photogenic string quartet. by which I'm not meaning to disparage the Australian string quartet at all, just to be clear. But the Kellermans are particularly good looking. the men and the women, I'm not being sexist, a very, very happening string quartet at the moment. They and really an extraordinary young group. We'll also have two late nights in the cathedral with the Adelaide Chamber Singers. Recently voted the world's best small choir, I will have you know, which is fantastic. And over two nights in St. Peter's, they'll do the complete motets of J.S. Bach, which is would be lovely. Now, there's only one more show to talk about, which is this one. This is the Black Armband. And as you're going to be able to work out fairly quickly as I start talking, the Black Armband are here. And I could not be happier, because I slightly fear for the Bass attendants outside once you've seen the next 10 minutes, because they may get crushed to death in the rush. I am delighted to say that we will close the festival with Dirt Song, the latest show from the Black Armband, which is basically the A-list of Australian musicians. I'm going to let them do it, because I don't have to say anything else, because you will see for yourself. We ran this, and all my staff were crying. And in a good way, not because I'd booked it. Many of you will already know about this band. It is the preeminent ensemble, which is brought together on a project-by-project basis and is able to just bring the cream of not just the musical talent in this country, but for our show, Archie Roach will be here, and Trevor Jamison will be here, and all these will just be part of the lineup. And I'm so delighted that I cannot think of a better way to close the festival. So I'm off. No one, steady on. There's always one. After the Black Armband perform, Laura Croach will come on and talk about Writers Week. Richard Grayson will come on and talk about his visual arts program. In the meanwhile, please let me leave, and then I'll come back on just for a bit, then you can drink. So please let me leave you in the capable hands of Greg Sheehan, Ian Grandage, Nigel McLean, Genevieve Lacey, Chuparu, and Delene Briscoe and Emma Donovan, the Black Armband.
The heart leaves no blood on my head.
there I would have roamed. My far, my far. Melaku nunggu wadai kuang wang bajile adogoi ai malie la jogondi
Hey, now. Thank you. There's a little expression we sometimes mutter among ourselves, which is, this is why we do this. And quietly confident that Dirt Song is why we do this. Extraordinary performance. Thank you so much. This piece, thank you. This piece was inspired by a novel called Carpentaria, and more importantly, the writer who was commissioned to write the narrative, the giant words you've just seen, was Alexis Wright, who will be appearing in Writers Week, which turns out to be a very nice segue. Yeah, it was terrifying until that moment. Trust me. My name is Laura Crouch, and it is a real delight and a privilege to be here this evening presenting my third Adelaide Writers' Week program. Not sure yet, but quietly confident this is going to turn out to be the best one yet. Fingers are crossed. Before I reveal some of the names that will be coming to talk to us in March, I'd like to thank my advisory committee, and in particular our chair, Peter Goldsworthy. This evening we are announcing 67 writers, and you'll be able to see that full list in the program when you get one as you leave. What I'm going to do this evening instead is run through some of the highlights, and I'm going to begin with the stars. We've got some real star power this year, and it is an honor to be bringing Margaret Jabel, Alexander McCall Smith, and Elizabeth Gilbert to Adelaide. Margaret Jabel is a must-see. I'm quietly confident she won't be returning to this part of the world again. The new novel is fantastic, and she is, in truth, a living legend. Alexander McCall Smith is the most charming man upon this planet, and this terrific writer is actually more fun in real life than he is on the page. He will be huge, uproarious fun. Elizabeth Gilbert, of Eat, Pray, Love mega fame, is in fact a novelist, and she returns to us with a novel, a very fine one. It's the story of a lady botanist, and it includes some very juicy bits. Lots of juicy bits. Fiction is at the heart of this festival, and this lineup's stunning. It is a delight to be hosting the 2013 Man Booker winner, Eleanor Catton, the 2013 Miles Franklin winner, Michelle de Kretzer, and I am fairly certain the 2014 Miles Franklin winner, as my prediction is it will come down to Richard Flanagan and Alexis Wright. I'm also enormously happy to be hosting two terrific American novelists, David Vann, who I suspect you all know, and Rachel Kushner, who I expect not many do. Yes, someone does. The Flamethrowers is among my novels of the year. One of the great pleasures in presenting this program is that we are able to support emerging writers. And this year we have a fantastic lineup, including our very own Hannah Kent, who someone had to email me today to verify it was a first novel, and I was also able to assure them that the film is underway. Alongside Hannah, we have the extraordinarily talented Fiona McFarlane and D.W. Wilson, who's a young Canadian writer. I would say that between those three, and I'm sure you've already read Hannah, your summer reading sorted. Next year, as you know, is the centenary of the First World War. And as we anticipate the centenary of the Anzacs in 2015, we have made a decision this year to focus on the First World War as a European war. We have invited three of our most celebrated historians to come to Adelaide and to have a conversation about the origins of that war. Nonfiction has become, for us, one of our most popular aspects of the program, and I'm thoroughly delighted to be invited to be hosting Young Chang, who you all know, for her earlier work. And can you believe I've just forgot Wild Swans? Almost forgot the name of it. As well as Marcus Chown, who is arguably the most famous science writer in the world, and my personal favorite, Dermot McCullough, who is the most famous church historian in the world, and a very naughty, fun person. For the first time in the history of Adelaide Writers' Week, we will be discussing the twilight world of comics. Comics Can Do Anything is a day that will take place here in the Festival Theatre, and it will feature the one and only Alison Bechdel, who is the most famous cartoonist in the world, and it's her very first time coming to Australia. It is unbelievably only since 2012 that we began our kids program, and it's doubled. So exciting is it that this year, on both Saturday and Sunday, we'll be running the kids program. And in our crazy story tent, which this year will be red, we'll be hosting not only Men Fox, but Andy Griffiths. The wonderful Asphyxia will be coming. She is a performer who performs in Auslan, and her stories, you'll know her from the Grimstones, are translated back into spoken word. And most thrillingly for me, we have real Punch and Judy, which means the parents will be appalled and the kids will be thrilled. Yeah, the proper kind. That's us. Thank you so much for coming, and I look forward to seeing you in March.
The 2014 Adelaide International is an exhibition that's called Worlds in Collision. And it's going to be showing work and projects by 9 international artists whose work operates at a place where one world sort of ends and another begins. Now, this may be something a bit literal, where we leave the atmosphere and venture out into space. Or it might be a bit more of an abstract boundary where one understanding of the world ends and we move into an alternative reality. Now, as a recent career retrospective at Tate Britain has just proven, Susan Hiller has long explored areas of human experience that lie just beyond established models. And for this work, which is the first new work that she's made since then, she has been assembling an archive of people's near-death experiences. People, tales of people leaving their bodies, traveling outwards, bright lights, white lights, you know the works. And these are expressed in this extraordinary luminous installation called Channels, using a bank of over 120 analog TV sets. Paul Laffoley, who's being recognized now as one of the most extraordinary visionary artists working, trained in classics and then at architecture, and then in architecture at Harvard. And he left that, worked for an architectural practice in New York, where he actually got to work on some of the early designs for the World Trade Center. And in 1965, he set up the Boston Visionary Cell. And this is a small room from where he generates intense, complex paintings, plans, and collages. And we are very lucky to be able to show a small retrospective of his work. Now, he considers these not to be paintings. It may look like one, but it's a machine. And it's a machine that allows us to understand the physical and philosophical structures of the universe, the natures of extraterrestrials, and the possibilities of time travel. Ra Damatino, however, doesn't use painting. She uses Google Maps to find ruins in the deserts of North Africa. And these are, in fact, the abandoned sets from Star Wars movies. And she documents the remains of intergalactic civilizations from the future. Now, to the people who live there, this is just more stuff that a rich country has left behind in a poor country. To others, it's the remains of Luke Walker's childhood farm. And to a few fervent fans, they're almost like holy sites as they've been raising money to return them to their former glory. Since 2009, Arthur Zhemievsky has been wandering around the globe recording political rallies and demonstrations. Now, each gathering with their banners and loud hailers is about something specific: a nationalism, ethnic identity, an ideology, an anger. But when experienced together across 34 screens in his installation Democracies, they suggest sort of wider ruptures and cracks where something energetic and perhaps dark might be coming through. The very wonderful Fred Tomaselli makes intense, detailed, layered works that, despite what you see here, quite often feature birds and canoes, because he's very fond of birds and canoes. He also works with patterns and plants. And they suggest gateways into intense psychedelic universes. And in this way, his paintings link to the sort of theological, mystical, and occult traditions, and to the sort of psychedelic cosmonauts who in the 60s were exploring new ways into the far out. Talking of which, Benedict Drew moves into the digital as much as the chemical, and he combines Tumblr with lumps of clay, wooden constructions, images, and music, and we walk through these spaces that are going doof, doof, doof. They're energized by pulsing sound and light, and they seem to sort of suggest an endless leakage between the new digital universes and the lumpy world of flesh in which we still move. Twice a month, since September, a small package arrives at the Adelaide Festival Centre. Not the Adelaide Festival Centre, at the Adelaide Festival office. And it's dropped off, papers are signed, and then it's picked up again. And this small box contains Second Moon by Katie Paterson. And that little lump you see there is a small lump of lunar meteorite. It's come from the surface of the moon, and she's placed it in orbit around the Earth for a year. And she's using commercial air freight companies. So this moon travels at a lower height than the other moon, 30,000 feet roughly, when cruising, as opposed to the 34,000 kilometers that the second moon does, but it does get to travel twice as fast. And through an app, we can map its progress and its position in its relationship to where we are, to where the moon is, and in relationship to the orbits of the other planets in the solar system. And it's also probably the first attempted space program that the Adelaide Festival's been directly involved in. The Lebanese Rocket Society documents the space exploration program that took place in the Lebanon in the 60s and 70s, and a bunch of professors and academics and scientists got together. So the work talks about the dreams of progress, ideas of the modern, and about a time when launching a rocket in the Lebanon had a slightly different meaning and loading than it does today. And when we look at their material that they've brought together, we can never quite tell if this is actually a world of fact or a world of fiction. And as usual, attached to all this is Adelaide's Artist Week, which will explore ideas and themes in the visual arts program generally. Now, a central element in this will be the Radical Enlightenment Project, which has been specially curated by the uber-cool curator and writer Lars Bang Larsen. But another highlight will be a presentation by the West Coast guru and author of Technosis, Myth, Magic, and Mysticism in the Age of Information, the visionary writer Eric Davis. So I hope you find something to enjoy.
Me again. Home stretch. Alcohol is really close. It is for me, it's right there. It's quite close for you as well. Thank you. One of the fantastic things about this job is you get to work with really smart people. And it's fantastic having Laura and Richard to work with on the program. It's also fantastic working with Nick Mitsovich, who this year will curate his own biennial of Australian art, going to the dark heart of art in Australia, of which there's quite a lot, it turns out. Funny that. It turns out we were both reading Robert Hughes's Fatal Shore at the same time. Some quite depressing conversations ensued, I have to say. But Nick's done an amazing job of curating the most extraordinary work from all over Australia with some fabulous... Trust me, you don't want me to start going through the list. We'll be here all bloody night. Just go. Nick is an extraordinary visionary curator and director, has done a fantastic job at the gallery, and I'm delighted that he's doing this himself because he's come up with an amazing show. As I am for the next show, Troy is doing, it's the 40th anniversary of Tanzania, and Troy Anthony Bayliss came to see me and said,
what do you want? Because obviously the 40th anniversary, by definition, takes place all year. He said, what do you want for the festival? I said, I want the most interesting new work. I want the cutting edge. I want the contemporary, because that's what makes sense in the context of the rest of the festival. We don't want a historical show. We don't want an ancient review show. We want cutting edge. And he's been as good as his word and come up with a fantastic, it's basically four shows. It's a review show of the four most interesting artists working in the Aboriginal contemporary art world at the moment. And it's a really, really brilliant show. And it's all the work that I could never hope to come close to, the knowledge that's necessary to do this stuff. So I'm enormously grateful to them all. All right, so home stretch. WOMAD Laid, of course. Oh, now hang on, what's that doing there? WOMAD's supposed to be next. Jason Sweeney's next. Let's speak. Speaking of local treasures. Good old Jason. He's a one-man local treasure. We did Stereo Public last year. And that was the Finding Quiet Spaces in Busy Places, which, of course, I never got the chance to do because I was too busy. But Jason, he won the TED Innovation Prize for that. And this year, we'll come up with an ambient radio station that you can tune into from your phone or go into various physical pods around town. I know there'll be a couple in the library. They're going to be around the place. Go on to his website. It's great to have someone like Jason around. He's a true visionary, and it's a real pleasure to have him back in the festival. As long as he keeps coming up with new ideas, I'll always put them in. All right, I'm completely out of order now. There's WOMAD. So WOMAD Laid is back, apparently with lots of gents' toilet signs dancing. No ladies' toilets, apparently, but they will be on site. WOMAD I constantly get asked, oh, don't you want to separate out all these things? And I have to say, no, I don't. It's fantastic. And I know it's busy. And I do feel for you. But I'm a big fan of the critical mass of what happens around the festival. And that there's so much on. And obviously, you have to make choices. I understand that. Trust me. You should try being me. I book these things. Try getting to all of them. And WOMAD Laid is obviously came out of the festival. It was started. It was Rob Brookman started it when he was in charge. And it's the only WOMAD in the world. And WOMAD is everywhere, in lots of places anyway. But it's the only WOMAD that came out of an established festival. And the Botanic Gardens, by the way, I have it from the horse's mouth, is Peter Gabriel's favorite site for WOMAD on the planet. And it is the perfect place for a music festival and the most civilized festival site in the world. And I feel like it's a part of the Adelaide Festival. And so if that sounds defensive, it's just because journalists keep asking me if it should move. It shouldn't move. It's right there in the heart of the festival, and there it will stay. Okay, and long may it last. Doc Week is another thing I'm extremely happy to have in the body of the festival. It was a huge success last year, and we've got it has that same this. Oh yes, oh yes, little murmur there. Another strong local connection apparently. I don't think I'll get to see this. It's only on the one night, and I've got about 9 other things in the festival. I'm dying to see it, though. Directed by Alex Gibney, who did Enron's Smartest Guys in the Room and Taxi to the Dark Side and all these amazing documentaries. But this will open the Doc Week public program, because there's an industry side and a public side. And I know there's Yost is a fantastic festival programmer, and he just rang me on 3 days ago to tell me about this. So that I like the murmur, though. That was a good murmur. Well done. All right, we're almost there. We are working very closely with the South Australian Museum because of the whole Edie Akron connection. I have to say, it's been a fantastic relationship. And they will run a whole program. They got very excited. We got very excited. We're all just excited. And I'm extremely indebted to Andrew Lowe and his staff at the museum. They've got involved. There'll be a whole kids program around the theme of fossils and the Edie Akron that will run for the entire festival on North Terrace. And it is great to be able to collaborate with the museum and with the gallery and to have these North Terrace institutions involved with the festival. Don't run that video yet. Hold that button. So, Barrio's dead. And I reckon that's okay, because we're not supposed to just do the same thing over and over again. Then we just become the Gardens. And we are... We can cut this out of the stream later, right? No, we can't? Oh, okay. The festival's supposed to be about changing things up, and we are in the luxury position of being able to go, let's do something different. And so this year, now you can press play. Lola's Pergola. And that's Lola as in the Kinks, not Lola as in Barry Manilow. I want to make that absolutely clear from the offset. And I want to make it clear how hard it is as an English person to say pergola, because it's pergola where I come from. Hey, down on the riverside, on the 2006 Persian Garden site, it's all about South Australia. We're plugging into the zeitgeist. It's all about the produce. You'll be able to eat there from 6 o'clock, pre-show dining with Duncan Velchamot. I think I got that right. Bistro Dom just got the best chef in South Australia last night. How of the moment are we? The whole thing is about being able to experience what's going on. It's the riverfront. It's winemakers. It's produce. It's so much what's going on at the moment. Lola's, because the general feedback was Barrio was fantastic, but a bit blokey. We went down the other way. There is no Lola. Just think Kinks, not Barry Manilow. It's still a club as well. You'll still be able to dance your bum off. We'll have a full program of DJs that will be announced later. That's looking quite tasty, I have to say. Oh, excuse me. So that's the club, and that's the festival. Is that all right? Is that all right? The one thing about this town is you don't have to say, is that all right? I know you're going to tell me. You'll stop me in the street. You'll stop me at the airport. You'll stop me at the bank. You'll stop me if I'm queuing up in the off license, which is great, actually. It was a bit scary at first because it doesn't happen in other places. But people come up to you and go, oh, about your festival. It's good, though. Keep doing it. Because apparently if you don't like it, you don't talk to me. So keep talking to me. Because I went back and asked in the office, what happens if they don't like your festival? No, they just ignore you. It's like, oh, shit. I hope I don't get ignored this year. All right, housekeeping. I thank you all for coming. I'm delighted now that it's public, and I won't make any mistakes by telling anyone about it. So it's great that it's out in the world. I really, really want to thank the staff at the Fezzi Centre, the fabulous production team, Taryn's Angels, here and for the festival. We have the best staff on the planet here. They really are awesome. What are the things marketing tell me to remember? It's the last 2 days of the early bird discount. Apparently, if you buy 2 tickets for Roman Tragedies, it's effectively free to become a friend. What's better than free? Bass is open. You can now be the first people to buy your tickets. I suggest if you don't buy a ticket for the Black Armband tonight, tomorrow could be too late. Can I also, while we're on the subject, just thank the Black Armband for being here? I will see you at the festival, and I'll see you at the bar. Go and get a drink. You've earned it.